Good morning and welcome to Highway Online. It's a joy and a privilege to be with you today. We trust today's message will be an encouragement to you in your walk of faith. If you live in the Sydney or Peninsula area, or perhaps you are visiting, we welcome you to our in-person service every Sunday at 10:30. We are located at 10364 McDonald Park Road in Sydney. We are right in between the airport and the ferry, right off the Patricia Bay Highway. If you would like more information concerning our church, connect with us at hcfsydney.ca, and someone would be happy to share with you, to pray with you, and you'll find all of our ministries right there. Just follow the links. God bless, and let's enjoy today's message.
One thing about VBS Sunday is trying to find your way up here. And Sue and her team have just done an awesome job in decorating and getting things ready. It's going to be such a fun week. Now, when you came in, you may have seen a bike. And one of the things that we're thrilled with, and we want to thank the generosity of those who have donated a bike to a child that's going to be riding off into the sunset this week. So we are so thankful for that. And listen, if you've got your Bibles, would you turn with me, please, to Jonah? Please turn with me to Jonah. And we're going to be reading Jonah chapter 2 in just a moment. Jonah chapter 2. I am really, really loving this book. As I have been reading and praying and studying, I am seeing so many wonderful things about God's grace. It's not just the story of a prophet who had the audacity to say no to God, but it's a story from beginning to end of God's amazing grace. And Jonah, as he gives testimony to what happens, he gives testimony that God's eye and hand is on him through every step of the way. Last week we looked at Jonah running from God. Today we're going to be looking at Jonah running to God as we look at his prayer that he prays in the middle of the Mediterranean Sea, in the middle of a great fish. Let me begin by telling you a story. There were three pastors who were gathered for coffee at Tim Hortons, and they were talking together about what they felt was the most appropriate and effective positions in which to pray. As they were talking together, sitting in the booth behind them was a hydro worker. And he listened intently as one pastor said, "The most effective way to pray is with our hands folded and raised to heaven." Another pastor waved, said, "No, no, no, that's not the way to pray. The way to pray is humbly on our knees." And then the third pastor said, "No, no, no, you've got it all wrong, guys. The only position worth its salt is to pray stretched out flat on your face on the floor." That must have been a Pentecostal pastor. By this time, the worker sitting behind them couldn't contain himself, and so he interrupted them and said, gentlemen, I have found that the most powerful prayer I have ever prayed while I was dangling upside down by my heels from a power pole suspended 40 feet above the ground. How many can identify with that feeling? You've come to the end of the rope and you're wondering, God, help! And sometimes that is the most effective, powerful prayer we could ever pray. Now, as we continue our series through the book of Jonah, we are going to be looking at the power of prayer. So turn with me to chapter 2. Actually, we're going to begin reading at the last verse of chapter 1, verse 17. Now the Lord provided a huge fish to swallow Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. Some people ask me, Pastor, do you actually believe this was a true story? Or do you think it was an allegory or a parable that was supposed to have a hidden meaning? And I answer affirmatively, yes, I do agree that this actually happened. That Jonah was real. That the call that God gave him was real. That he disobeyed, and in his rebellion of not wanting to preach to Nineveh, he purchased a ticket to get on a boat to travel 2,500 kilometers to the south of Spain, as far away as anyone could ever get. He thought he could get as far away from the will of God. But what Jonah would learn is that you can never get far from his eye, because he is ever watching. He is ever looking. His hand is ever holding us. And when God calls, we better listen. Yes, I believe it's true. Jesus believed it was true. He alluded to Jonah being in the fish for 3 days as illustrating and prophetically stating what would happen to him when he would die on the cross, and then after 3 days in the tomb, he would rise from the dead. And folk, if Jesus was simple enough to believe that this was true, I think I can believe Jesus. How about you? I believe it's true because the Bible is full of miracles. And folk, if we take the supernatural out of the Word of God, well, we won't have much left, will we? If we take the supernatural out of the Bible, then all we are left with is, well, a lot of do's and don'ts and rules and regulations that do not give life. But this word, the inspired word of God, tells us about a miracle-working God who is active in each and every one of our lives. And as he is alive and active in your life, he was active and alive in Jonah's life, beginning with God's call to go to Nineveh. Jonah was a prophet. He is referred to by theologians as a minor prophet. That does not mean that his message was inconsequential. What it simply means is that this prophecy only contains 54 total verses compared to the book of Isaiah or Jeremiah or Ezekiel. Jonah's message, though short, is poignant and powerful and life-changing. Jonah was called by God, though he was a prophet to Israel. He was walking in the courts of the palace, speaking to royalty. And God takes him from the palace and says, I want you to go with my word and go to Nineveh. And it takes him just a few seconds to simply shake his head and say, no way, Jose, no way am I going there. They don't deserve God's grace. Jonah knew, as he testifies later in his book, that God is a God of grace. And not only was he a God of grace to the Jewish people, the Jewish nation, but he was a God of grace to the Gentiles and to those who did not yet know him. And Jonah did not want the Gentiles, especially Nineveh, to hear about God's grace and forgiveness. So he sets himself to rebel against God, gets on a boat to Tarshish, and during that time, God's eye is on Joshua. And he causes a storm, a great windstorm, to arise that rocks that boat to its very core. The people do not know what's going on. They call out to Jonah, who was asleep in the hull. And Jonah confesses to his rebellion and disobedience. He says to them, throw me into the water. Now, some would suggest that Jonah was being, you I'm sacrificing myself. No, understand something. Jonah so much did not want to obey God, he was willing to be thrown into the water, then have the boat turn around so he could go to Nineveh and preach. Reluctantly, the people take Jonah, they throw him into the Mediterranean Sea, and as he sinks into the murky darkness of that water, the sea becomes calm as crystal. In fact, ironically, though Jonah did not want to preach to the Gentiles, these Gentiles who were on this boat, they themselves turned to faith in Jehovah God. It seemed like the end. It seemed this was it. You could probably end it right here at verse 16. But at verse 17, God's eye and hand is on Jonah. Now the Lord provided a huge fish to swallow Jonah, and Jonah was in the belly of the fish 3 days and three nights. Theologians and Bible teachers do not know at what point in this period that Jonah woke up and came to himself. Perhaps it was sometime at the end of that third night. From inside the fish, Jonah prayed. He prayed to the Lord his God. He said, "In my distress, I called to the Lord, and he answered me. From deep in the realm of the dead, I called for help. You went, listened to my cry. You hurled me into the depths, into the very heart of the sea. And the current swirled around me. All your waves and breakers swept over me. I said, I have been banished from your sight. Yet I will look again toward your holy temple. The engulfing waters threatened me. The deep surrounded me. Seaweed was wrapped around my head. To the roots of the mountains I sank down. The earth beneath barred me forever. But you, Lord my God, brought my life up from the pit. When my life was ebbing away, I remembered you, Lord, and my prayer rose to you, to your holy temple. Those who cling to worthless idols turn away from God's love for them. But I, with shouts of grateful praise, will sacrifice to you. What I have vowed, I will make good. I will say salvation comes from the Lord. And the Lord commanded the fish, and it vomited Jonah onto dry land. When the word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time, go to the great city of Nineveh and proclaim to it the message I give you. Lord, just thank you again for your word. Now, Holy Spirit, only you can take your word, take this message, and you can open our ears to hear your voice today. Only you, Holy Spirit, can open our eyes to see the way that Father would have us to go. And only you, Holy Spirit, can anoint our hearts and our feet to be ready to respond to your call today. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen. Timothy Keller, in his book on Jonah, writes, "The great fish is a perfect example of severe mercy." You see, there are those who would suggest that this was a severe punishment by God to Jonah. After all, didn't he deserve to be punished? He was running from God, wasn't he? Didn't he deserve some kind of punishment? But I want us to understand that this action by God in bringing this great fish was not a means of being punitive, but it was a means of being redemptive. And as Timothy Keller continues to write, the fish saved Jonah's life by swallowing him. On the other hand, he was still in the watery prison. He was still sinking in the bottom of the world, to the roots of the mountains, far from help and hope. He was still alive, but for how long? It was only a temporary respite unless God provided another act of deliverance. Peter Craigie writes that when we reject and disobey God as Jonah did, it takes radical treatment if it is to be remedied. And Timothy Keller further points out that the text has been depicting Jonah as descending, going down to Joppa, down into a ship, down into the depths of the ship. And now, finally, he goes even further down into the depths of the ocean. But not until he is all the way down, finally stripped of his own buoyant self-sufficiency, now deliverance was possible. You see, if Jonah was to begin finally to ascend, both in the water and in his faith, he had to be brought to the very end of himself. The way up was first down. The usual place to learn the greatest secrets of God's grace. I love what Tim Keller says. The usual place to learn the greatest secrets of God's grace is at the bottom. And it's not simply being at the bottom that begins to change Jonah, but prayer at the bottom. In verse 7, he says, "When my life was ebbing away, I remembered you, Lord, and my prayer rose to you, to your holy temple." And it's here that we have the key to renewal. It's here that we have the key to restoration. It's here that we understand what repentance is. It's this key that unlocks God's grace and mercy. Satan, our enemy, would have us believe that we're too far gone, that there's no use to pray. But listen to me, church. When the devil says it's too late to pray, don't believe it, because it's never too late to pray. Hallelujah. The fact that Jonah could pray to God from the belly of a fish and that God heard him from there reminds us that there is no place and no circumstance that we find ourselves in where we cannot connect with God through prayer and receive comfort and help from him in our time of need. Our prayers are powerful because of the God to whom we are praying, not because of the place, posture, or circumstance of our prayer. Oftentimes we find ourselves, like Jonah, in over our heads. We're going down for the third time. We're reaching up and it seems there is nothing there to help us. And it's at those moments we can do one of two things. We can, first of all, continue to strive to get out of our trouble in our own strength, finding ourselves going further down in the deep, or we can discover the power of God's loving kindness and mercy that is found as we submit to his will in prayer. There are four things that we learn from Jonah's prayer. Four things that teach us about prayer and teach us about God. And the first thing I want us to see is how Jonah remembers God's faithfulness in prayer. At the beginning of his prayer, Jonah says, "In my distress," I want you to underline or circle those words or write them down. The word is the Hebrew word Sarah, T-S-A-R-A-H, Sarah. It's a word, a picture word. It's a word that's used when a woman is going into labor. It means the travail of childbirth. It means the distress of labor. It means the tension as if someone is in the pain of childbirth. He writes, "In my distress, in the agony, as if I'm about to give birth, I called unto God and he answered me." Another way to put it is, in other words, he's saying, from the point in which I was furthest from God, the point where I was miserable and had no way to do anything about it, from the place where I was helpless and desperate and afraid and hurting, this is where I called out to God. Jonah says, "I was as good as dead, but God in his mercy would cause me Sarah, would cause me that place where I would be in such distress, I could only but call to God." Has anyone ever been in that place where you didn't know how to pray? You didn't know what to pray. All you felt was agony. All you felt was pain. All you felt was that silence of heaven, and you just wanted to blurt out, and all it felt was pain. But I want you to understand something. That is Sarah at work. That is God at work, and he's about to bring forth something new. That which you think is hopeless, he's going to give birth to hope. That which you think is full of pain, he's going to bring healing. That which you think is God turning away, he's going to show you his love and mercy, that he's still on the throne. He's still hearing you. He is giving you, Sarah, his loving mercy. Jonah says, I remembered you, Lord, and my prayer rose to you. Remembering God's love and mercy and responding to it through prayer is the first step in renewing a relationship with God. If we have found ourselves walking away in that place where we shouldn't be with God, the first thing we do is pray. And when we are at our lowest, we pray even more, because that's when we discover that God is faithful. Hebrews 10:23 says, let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. You can trust him today. You can maintain your faith in him today, because God is faithful to keep his promises. This is where our faith is rooted and grounded. His faithfulness gives us confidence to persevere when life gets hard. When doubts creep in, when we don't know where to turn, he is faithful and he will never leave us. And maybe today you're finding yourself in the belly of a different kind of great fish. The first step is to call unto him in prayer. Remember that God is with you. He's listening. Sometimes God has to shake us so hard that only the unshakable remains. We need to remember his faithfulness. And as we do, like Jonah, we need to repent of our unfaithfulness. In verse 9, Jonah says, up to verse 9, Jonah has been describing how he's been feeling. He's lost. He's without hope. He's at the point of death and of no return. And then he experiences God's mercy. And in response to that recognition, he prays, but I, with a song of thanksgiving, will sacrifice to you, and what I vowed, I will make good. In other words, Jonah is saying, realizing his folly in trying to run from God's mission, he turns to God in prayer. I don't know if he was able to lift up his head in that fetal position in the belly of that whale, but his heart was saying, God, I turn to you, and I will speak your word just as you called me to. You see, repentance is more than just feeling sorry for your sin. Sunday school teacher once asked his class what was meant by the word repentance. Little Johnny put up his hand and said, it's being sorry for your sins. Little Susie also raised her hand and added, it's being sorry enough to quit. Repentance is a lot more than just saying that you're sorry for your sin, but it's actively, intentionally turning toward God and following his way and doing what he's called us to do. It's agreeing with God. As John tells us in 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sin and purify us from all unrighteousness. The word confess here in the Greek means to that something that is said or communicated. When you join these words, it means agreement or covenant. When we confess our sins, we are agreeing with God about what we have done and the seriousness of our actions. When we repent, when we turn to God, when we confess, we are saying, God, I've blown it. I've sinned against heaven and against you, and we recognize that sin. And some of you may be thinking, well, Pastor, you know, that's okay for someone living on the street who's, you know, destroyed their lives by drugs and all kinds of a licentious lifestyle, but that's not me, Pastor. You know, I'm here in church. I follow the Bible, I obey the Ten Commandments, I memorize Scripture, I'm going to be part of VBS. I mean, if that doesn't impress God, what will? You see, repentance and confession is not about impressing God. Our actions have nothing to do with impressing God. It's our spirit that says, God, I can't do it on my own. And you may be here and you may be say, yeah, I'm not committing any grave sin. I'm not walking in any known rebellion. But maybe you are here and maybe you've been working so hard for the Lord and what you're doing is good and coming and serving in VBS is great. But why are you doing it? Are you doing it because you want to serve God, or are you doing it because you want to impress God? Revelation 2:3, Jesus speaks to the church at Ephesus who was doing everything right. Ephesus was the kind of church we want to be a member of. They were doing everything right. Jesus says, you've persevered and have endured hardships for my name and have not grown weary. Yet I hold this against you. You have forsaken your first love. Remember the height from which you have fallen. Repent and do the things you did at first. What is Jesus saying to the Ephesian church? He's saying, look, you're doing all the right stuff. You're coming to church. You're giving. You're teaching. You're witnessing. Your worship team is the best in the city. You've got it all. Something that I know I have to guard in my own heart, that I don't get to that place as I do from time to time, where it becomes just by rote, where I'm doing it just because. And I need to come to God at those times and ask his forgiveness and ask him, Holy Spirit, as we sang just a moment ago, Lord, Holy Spirit, I need you. I need renewal. I need revival. I need you to restore that joy again. I need to restore that first love. Maybe that's where some of you are today. You may not have rebelled, but maybe you're resisting because you need God to give you a fresh renewal of his spirit. We need to be reminded of the amazing grace of God's mercy. We need to turn to him in repentance, and then we need to rejoice in his salvation. Jonah's prayer ends with a shout. As he's been piecing together the incredible, amazing grace of God, the wonder of it all dawns on him. And he gives this climactic statement in verse 9. Salvation comes only from the Lord. As he considers God's call, as he considers the mission God gave him to do, he now realizes the light bulb comes on in his head. And that what was in the light in his head now shines in his heart as he realizes it's not about me. It's not about how I'm going to talk. It's not about how others are going to be responding. It's all about the Lord. And if I'm going to be saved, if I'm going to be delivered, it's not going to be because I'm good enough. It's not going to be because I pray enough. It's not going to be because I sing enough. It's going to be because he is enough. Hallelujah. Salvation belongs to him. Keller writes, salvation belongs to God alone, to no one else. If someone is saved, it's wholly God's doing. It's not a matter of God saving you partly and you saving yourself partly. No, God saves us. We do not and cannot save ourselves. That's the gospel. And my friends, when we find Jesus, when we repent of our sin, when we become sons and daughters of God, our walk with him becomes nothing less but total, complete reliance upon his grace. And when we do, like Jonah, we can rejoice. But pastor, he's in the middle of a whale of a fish. Thank you, Trevor. He's in the middle of a great fish. What must that have been like? Well, let me share with you what it could have been like. or at least what how Chuck Swindoll describes it. It's pitch black. Sloshing gastric juices wash over you. Burning skin, eyes, throat, and nostrils. Oxygen is scarce, and each frantic gulp of air is saturated with salt water. The rancid smell of digested food causes you to throw up repeatedly until you have only dry heaves left. Everything you touch has the slimy feel of the mucous membrane that lines the stomach. You feel claustrophobic. With every turn and dive of that great fish, you slip and slide in the cesspool of digestive fluid. There are no footholds, no blankets to keep you warm from the cold, clammy depths of the sea. For 3 days and three nights, you endure the harsh womb of God's grace. Wow. How can I pray? Because God is with you. How can I praise? Because God is with you. And he's worthy. Christians make this audacious claim. Joy and suffering are neighbors. For some, this comes across as naive, as if Christians are ignorant of all the pain and suffering in this world that's filled with tyranny, oppression, poverty, starvation, abuse, and violence. But the Bible makes it clear that joy found in God is powerful and permanent enough to sustain us even through even the most trying and sorrowful of circumstances. David prayed, "Restore to me the joy of your salvation." Nehemiah, when the people were in the midst of great depression and discouragement, cried, "Do not grieve, for the joy of the Lord is your strength." Isaiah, in Isaiah 40, reminds us, "Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not faint." Hallelujah. Yes, give them praise, church. Hallelujah. And as he praises, as he's praying, God sees him. God's hand is undergirding him. As they're getting closer and closer to shore, what Jonah cannot see, God orchestrates and commands the fish, "It's time." And with one gulp, Jonah finds himself covered in gastric juices on the shore. And what does he do? "Which way to Nineveh?" And Jonah is given a second chance. Chapter 3, I love how it begins. "The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time." God gives Jonah a second chance to get it right. And part of repentance that we mentioned earlier is not just a changed heart and a changed will. It means a changed behavior. It means going back and starting where you left off. Jonah is given a second chance to obey the command. And this is the real test of obedience. So God says to Jonah, "Go to Nineveh." Aren't you glad he's the God of second chances? He always gives us a second chance. No matter what you've done, how many times you've done it, God will always give you a second chance. As he restored Jonah to his original call, he will restore you. Sometimes we think that there are things that God can never forgive us of, but when sin abounds, grace much more abounds. The safest, most secure place you can be is in the center of his will. He's calling you today. He's calling you today. He He's calling you back into his presence. He's calling you back to his purpose. He's calling you back to be on mission with him. Let me close with this story. In his book, No Wonder They Call Him Savior, Max Licato tells the story to illustrate God's love, grace, and concern for those who are lost. Longing to leave her poor Brazilian neighborhood, Christina wanted to see the world. Discontent with a home, having only a pallet on the floor for a bed, a wash basin, and a wood-burning stove, she dreamed of a better life in the city. One morning, she slipped away, breaking her mother's heart. Knowing what life on the streets would be like for her young, attractive daughter, Maria hurriedly packed to go find her. On her way to the bus stop, she entered a drugstore to get one last thing, pictures. She sat in the photograph booth, closed the curtain, and spent all she could on pictures of herself. With her purse full of small black and white photos, she boarded the next bus to Rio de Janeiro. Maria knew Christina had no way of earning money. She also knew that her daughter was too stubborn to give up. When pride meets hunger, a human will do things that were before unthinkable. Knowing this, Maria began her search. Bars, hotels, nightclubs, any place with a reputation for streetwalkers or prostitutes. She went to them all, and at each place she left her picture taped on a bathroom mirror, tacked to a hotel bulletin board, fastened to a corner phone booth. And on the back of each photo, she wrote a note. It wasn't too long before both the money and pictures ran out and Maria had to go home. The weary mother wept as the bus began its long journey back to her small village. It was a few weeks later that young Christina descended the hotel stairs. Her young face was tired. Her brown eyes no longer danced with youth, but spoke of pain and fear. Her laughter was broken. Her dream had become a nightmare. 1,000 times over, she had longed to trade those countless beds for her secure pallet. Yet the little village was, in too many ways, too far away. As she reached the bottom of the stairs, her eyes noticed a familiar face. She looked again. And there on the lobby mirror was a small picture of her mother. Christina's eyes burned and her throat tightened as she walked across the room and removed the tiny photo. Written on the back was this compelling invitation. Whatever you've done, whatever you've become, it doesn't matter. Please come. Never too late. No matter how far you've come, no matter how long you've turned, it's never too late. It's never too late to pray. It's never too late to receive his grace. It's never too late to rejoice in his salvation. And it's never too late for a second chance. Hallelujah. Aren't you glad for the God of the second chance today?
Thank you for joining us today. If you would like prayer, or perhaps you would like to give to the Ministry of Highway, you can connect with us at hcfsydney.ca. Follow the links, and you will find the contact information for our church to reach a pastor, and we would be happy to serve you in whatever way we can. God bless, and we'll see you again next time. ¶¶